So in the last video of this series, we talked about Blade Expert, but it was really a high-level overview of it, right? We didn't get into the nitty-gritty detail of how to control the machining process or get the exact results you need to get your part within specification. Now, I've done a bunch of testing over here on our Akuma with the Nikon rotary, and I'd like to share some of that here and some things that I learned while I ran through this. So let's go into Mastercam and check that out. All right, so when I'm looking at a Blade Expert operation like this, it can get pretty busy visually. One of the biggest things I'll do is come into advanced display and turn that on with my retract motion shut off. Now that allows me to see the true cut pattern here and really make it much simpler to understand what's happening in that cut. Now, like we talked about in a previous video, Blade Expert is stock aware, right? So I do that initial roughing pass here, and then I create a stock model. And I can reference that in a future operation. Now, something we didn't talk about in the first operations was using an OptiRough for my first roughing operation, and then creating a stock model, and then referencing that stock model in a Blade Expert operation. Remember, Blade Expert doesn't need to start from a raw blank. We can rough that however we see fit, and then come back to Blade Expert and do the rest roughing. Now, if I go into the parameters of Blade Expert, let's take a look in here. Blade Expert has a lot of different strategies when we're roughing. We can do offset from hub, offset from shroud, or morph between shroud and hub. The problem with morphing between the shroud and hub is that they're not going to maintain equal step overs throughout that cut. Where the blade is shallower, you're going to have less of a step over and a deeper step over up towards the leading edge. I'm going to pick offset from hub for this. Now we also have a lot of sorting and ordering options that can control climb versus conventional. We can do one way, start from leading edge, zigzag. We can do a lot of different options here. And there's center away versus left to right or right to left. From center away would typically be the most desirable cut. That allows me to do that full slot right up the center of the blades, keeping any chatter away from the walls or those blades that I'm going to be coming back and finishing later. Now for this part, I actually found going up against that left wall and then working across to the right with climb cuts worked out better, so that's what I used here. When roughing with Blade Expert, I can also avoid incomplete depths. This means that if the tool cannot make an entire pass between the two blades, it will eliminate that pass. In most cases, I actually want to cut as much material as I can with the largest tool diameter I can, so I'll leave this on. We also have the ability to add intermediate slices to the first cut. And in this part, I found that that was actually advantageous, especially with the way I was doing that deep channel up against one of the blades. So in this case, I add two intermediate slices. Let's head over to the feed rate control. Here, I can specify a final cut feed rate or a first cut feed rate. In this case, I used 50% for my first cut feed rate. I also have the ability to replace any rapids with feed moves. That really depends on your machine and what it likes to see for rapid moves. Some machines in simultaneous five axes actually prefer feed moves. So that's a brief walkthrough on some of the options inside of Blade Expert. I'm going to X out of here for now, and let's do a quick verify on this rest material removal that we're doing with this second Blade Expert op. So I'm going to set up my simulator options to look at Blade Expert 1 stock model, click OK, and I'm going to run a verify on this. I'll slow this down so we can look at the motion that's occurring here. Now you'll notice that tool is staying in contact with the part at all times. I'll slow this even a little further. It is not doing any air cuts, right? As soon as it comes out of material, it starts for the next pass. So that's really an advantage of using stock and using rest material in Blade Expert. Okay, so let's move on to finishing this impeller. Let's take a look at Mastercam. So you'll notice that I have this Blade Expert operation finishing this splitter. And again, I can see the rapids or shut them off with advanced display. And you'll notice that I'm coming parallel from this hub, right? The first pass is parallel and it remains that way, parallel to that hub, all the way throughout that cut. Now, let me copy this down. I'll go into the parameters here and I'm gonna change strategies on my cut pattern. And in this case, I'm gonna, instead of using offset from hub, let's switch to morph between shroud and hub. The other thing I'm going to do is coming to my linking, and I'm gonna make this a blend spline. That just changes how it links. Before, you saw the tool was retracting at the end on that trailing edge every single time, retracting and then feeding back into the part. We'll try with a blend spline this time. Let's click OK out of here, and then regenerate this toolpath. All right, with that toolpath regenerated, we can start to see the differences here. We're getting those blend splines that we talked about. And if I turn on both of these toolpaths together, I'll hold down the control key and turn them on, you can see the differences in the cut pattern there, right? One's staying parallel and one's morphing from the top to the bottom. You can see how they crisscross and almost run almost 90 degrees to each other in some places. These step overs could have big ramifications on airflow. So I actually did this on a part when I was testing because I wanted to see what pattern I wanted to run, what was most efficient, what looked best on the machine. And the results of that are here. So if you look at this, we actually have a morph pattern down on this first blade. I did a parallel to shroud on this second one. And then on this third blade, we're staying parallel to the floor or the hub. So coming back into Mastercam, let's backplot this operation number 7. I'll launch backplot and let this thing run. Now, as we come to the bottom, you'll notice something, right? Our tool is coming through this next blade. And obviously we can't run this on the machine. That's not gonna work very good. Now, why is that? Well, the reason for that is when selecting our geometry or our part definition for blades and splitter, I only picked, and we can look at this, but I've only picked that center splitter blade, right? As of right now, Blade Expert has no idea that there's other blades next to here. And if I want to convey that to the toolpath, I have to select them. Now, I don't want to cut them. So instead, let's choose them as avoidance geometry. And here I'll just pick this top edges that I'm concerned about hitting. And I'll do the other side too, because it's possible I might hit that one. End selection, and let's regenerate. Okay, regeneration is done. Let's shut advanced display off. And look at all these retracts, right? The toolpath really kind of falls apart here. Now, why is that? I think one easy way to explain it is to look in backplot. And if we do, if we go down to one of these retracts, and I'll just click that portion of the toolpath, we can see that the tool basically comes around and almost hits that blade. Now, why is that happening? And why are we getting such a significant tilt against the blade that we're cutting? Let's go back into the parameters and I'll show you something. If we go to the tool axis control page, you'll notice that we have 30 thousandths on the holder, 30 thousandths on the shank, and on the shoulder. Now, because we're using this tapered ball nose end mill, it has really short flutes on it, which is advantageous for rigidity, but it creates a problem when we add 30 thousandths of clearance to the shank, because that shank has to tip away so far from the surface in order to clear. So instead, let's bump these numbers down. We can leave the holder alone because we're not anywhere near the holder, but let's change these to 1 thou. This should help significantly for that tool to fit in between the blades. I'll click generate toolpath and click OK. All right, after that's done generating, you can see we got rid of all those retracts, right? That's a good looking toolpath now. We can come back into backplot here. And even up on this front leading edge, we're not having to tilt so far away, and it fits right between those blades without issue. So things are looking a lot better here. So this looks pretty good, right? We've got great tool axis control, it generated pretty automatically. Everything looks nice. Now the problem is here we've pretty much given Blade Expert free rein with lead or lag on the tool, allowing that tool to lead from the cutting edge or to lag from the cutting edge. And we can't always do that, right? Depending on material constraints or the tool design, whether it's center cutting or not, we may not be able to drive that tip of the tool into material. But there is controls in Blade Expert for that. So let's take a look. So lead and lag is important when finishing, but even more important with roughing, and the controls are the same. So let's look at this roughing toolpath. And on the tool axis control page, you'll see we have a preferred lead angle, a minimum lead angle, and a max lead angle, right? The max lead angle, I don't find to be as important. We can leave that larger to let the tool get some movement to allow it to fit in between the blades and do what it needs to do. Same thing with side tilt, right? The more side tilt you get, the closer you get to that tool tip, but something like 30 to 45 degrees is fine, and typically it won't use all of that because it can't fit in between the blades. The big thing here is minimum lead angle. For roughing, typically you'd want to leave that at 0 or even at 1 degree, right? Because that's going to keep that tool tip that we talked about off the center and from plunging into material. So as long as it's above 0, it's typically okay. Now when it comes to finishing, you usually have a little more tolerance there because of the way you're contacting the part. So with finishing, I will sometimes allow up to minus 5 degrees on lead angle, which is basically defining lag. The other consideration we have here is machine angle limits. On the Akuma here, the Nikon rotary can only rotate with a B rotation of 105 degrees. So we need to be aware of that in here, and sometimes I'll put a little cushion in it. So for our machine angles, I can say, well, we can come up to 0, but things get a little unstable at 0. So I'll put 10 degrees in, and a max machine angle of 95 degrees. That keeps us well off the 105 degree limit. The next option we can look at is underneath the part definition, and that is tool axis smoothing. So we can really adjust the smoothing parameters of how that tool axis works on the part. Now there is a happy medium. So tool axis smoothing control really depends on the complexity of the impeller and the geometry that the impeller has, right? And it's really something that's perceived at the machine. If you see your rotaries are moving really choppy or not really acting very smooth, that's what this setting does. Now, this isn't the most complex impeller, but it's also not the easiest. So I found in my testing, staying between 20 and 40% really yielded good results on the machine, and that's what we used here. All right, so let's move on to the hub finishing here. I've already got a hub finishing operation programmed. You can see how nice that looks down on the base of this part. Now, what I really want you to pay attention to is these flow line areas around the splitter. You can see how that toolpath blends from each side and comes back to the center to machine the part. We have control over how that works around the splitter inside of Blade Expert. Launching parameters, I'll head over to part definition. And here you can see, similar to that tool axis smoothing area, I have a splitter flow line smoothing. So for hub finishing, this is where you're really gonna see that. I can crank this up to 100%, right? This is gonna smooth out that area. I'll let that regenerate. And you'll see how it doesn't come back to center nearly as quickly. That's gonna create a really smooth motion on the rotaries of the machine, but it might not meet the specification of your part. Now, to look at this from an opposite perspective, let's go back into parameters and turn this down to 0. I'll let that regen. So this is really the opposite of what we were seeing before, right? This is gonna machine all of that area in front of that leading edge, not miss any of it, but the results on the machine might be less than ideal. Let's take both scenarios, put them on the machine, and see what we get. So there's definitely some subtle differences between 0% smoothing and 100% smoothing. Finding what works for your part and your machine is really what you need to dial in. As we can see with these smoothing options, machining's always a compromise, right? You have to decide between what's gonna work best for the part, what's gonna work best for the machine, and what process is going to work best for you. Now that we've got things proven out and we know where we wanna go from here, we have the next hurdle in front of us. We've only been working on one segment. How do we program this entire part? Well, Mastercam has two options. We can use regular toolpath transform, or we can use the transformations that can happen inside of Blade Expert to program multiple segments. Let's take a look. So the first option for programming something like this is to go into our toolpath transform function. So if I click on toolpath transform, I could take all of these prior operations that did one segment and do a rotation. And since I'm rotating four more times, and this is 360 degrees divided by five. So that's gonna be a 72 degree rotation. My initial transformation will be at 72 degrees, and each one following will be 72 degrees after that. My rotation plane will be along the top plane, which is the center of the impeller. So I could do it this way, but I wanna point out another, possibly more advantageous way. What I can do is inside the Blade Expert toolpath, instead of selecting that one segment, I can go in and pick all the different blade segments. So I pick each and every blade and splitter, all the fillets, and the hub. So Blade Expert has this segment section of the toolpath. I can machine all segments, or I can do it determined by number and pick one. Now that's what we've been doing up to this point, right? Only programming that one segment. But we could have selected the entire model and then programmed that one segment. After that, we could then just up this number to program all, not changing a single parameter. So I'm gonna do all in this case. And once I do that, you'll see that I get all the motion I need on that entire part. The entire thing is programmed. Now, what's the advantage of this? Why not just do one segment at a time and move it around? Well, if I'm roughing the impeller, it might be better to do all of it at one depth, move around the part, drop down, do another depth. That keeps the heat concentrations to a minimum, and it also keeps the blank as rigid as possible as we move down through the part. Let's post this out, put it on the machine, and see the difference. Blade Expert is a very capable and powerful package, and it's not something that we could show you every single option in this one video, but I hope this gave you a sense of what Blade Expert can do and how it may be able to help you. Whether you do one impeller a year, or it is the core of your business and you're doing them every day, Blade Expert can make that so much easier. So we're not quite done with this project yet. We're gonna take Blade Expert and take it to the next level with some third-party solutions. Things that can optimize the Blade Expert motion even further. If you're doing this type of work every day, you're going to want to tune in.